I'm going to talk about something that we cannot see, and we're going to visualize it today together. So let me start with a very simple question about who are we? As a microbiologist, and as a geneticist, as a biologist, when I look at all of you right now, I see one human with 30 trillion bacteria inside you. That's right. At this very moment, all of us are carrying 30 trillion bacteria. They are invisible, they are amazing, they do stupendous things for us. They help us digest our food, they help us act as sentinels of our immune system, but we never see them. Ladies and gentlemen, meet your microbiome, okay? But what we know about bacteria and infectious diseases is the dark side of this interaction we have with them, which is commonly known as disease, and we all are familiar with epidemics of plague, cholera, and right now, the ongoing pandemic of Ebola that's going on in Africa, in our country a little bit too, right? So how do these relationships shift from being 30 trillion harmless people to making us sick? And what can we do? So throughout humanity, we have been combating bugs in different ways. And in the 20th century, we discovered something called antibiotics. Now, antibiotics are these small molecules or drugs that you take, you eat, or you inject, and they kill the bacteria in your body, okay? Unfortunately, they end up killing both the good and the bad, and that's a problem. So while we were innovating, bacteria were innovating too. They were like, oh, okay. So what they did is, like, they became resistant to almost all the antibiotics that we have. So I had shoulder surgery 5 years back, and when I talked to my physician after coming out of surgery, the list of antibiotics I was put on was crazy. I was like, wow. And then he or she at that point, they both told me that this is the current state where many bugs that we have now are not treated with these antibiotics that we have. And the numbers are staggering. So every year, 6.9 million kids die before they reach their fifth birthday. Out of these children, approximately 2 million kids die due to pneumonia and diarrhea, and these are infectious diseases. If you see, there is no Ebola on this slide. We need to start a conversation about managing infectious diseases better in our world that we live in. And President Barack Obama, in September of this year, issued an executive order. And the order states that scientists, innovators, community members like you, all of us should come together and brainstorm in a better way to manage infectious diseases, because our current arsenal of antibiotic drugs which can treat antibiotics has been depleted. Okay? So to solve these things, there are a couple of things that we need to know. The first thing we need to know that we will have access to a patient whom we will call John. Okay? And John consistently falls ill because he drinks contaminated water and gets diarrhea. And before we leave this room, we're going to make sure John gets better. Okay? That's the task for today. So diarrhea is a serious disease. It kills approximately 2,000 kids every day, right? So let's simulate a quick diarrheal infection in this room, quickly. If we were in John's body right now, and these were the walls of John's intestine, and all of you were bacteria, there were two things you did when you entered John's body. The first thing you did is you grabbed a seat, right? That's what you did when you entered this room. The second thing you did as soon as you entered is you looked for food. And that's exactly what infectious agents do. They get inside our body, they find a place to park themselves, and they start eating, okay? And these are usually called dietary requirements of infectious agents. As a microbiologist, I am passionate to not kill bacteria first before we understand what they do to us. Till now, we have been killing them without understanding what they do. So let's change the approach a little bit here, okay? So this is John drinking contaminated water, and this is you in John's guts coming in. You grab the seed, right? And John's body provides you with this amazing food that you love, right? And the bugs eat these food molecules that John's body naturally provides them, and they become virulent, pathogenic, and John gets diarrhea, obviously, right? So I decided to intersect into this problem in a different way. I wanted to understand what are the food sources our body provides to bacteria when they cause infection. And the technology I use to understand that is called metabolomics. What metabolomics does is basically allows you to take any biological sample, infected sample, from a patient, from an animal, and ask and lets you understand, get a peek or eavesdrop into the conversation that's happening between a patient and a bacterium, and understand what are the food sources that the body is producing when we are sick. And these food sources are usually called metabolites. And these are food sources that bugs get when we get infected. Okay? With this information, I was able to build a Google map of all the metabolites you get when you're sick in the context of diarrhea, in the context of a couple of other infectious diseases. And these are the metabolites your body produces once you get sick. Okay? Apparently, humans have been dealing with bacteria before we invented antibiotics, right? Antibiotics are in the 20th century. It turns out when you're sick, your body produces two different kinds of metabolites. The first metabolite your body produces are these blue ones, which are called pathogenic metabolites. These pathogenic metabolites, when the bugs eat them, they produce millions of molecules of toxins. And this is the toxin molecule that the bugs produce, and you get sick. On the other hand, your body also produces millions of molecules, small amounts or trace amounts, or depending on the infection, these are the green metabolites. They're just colored here for understanding. And these green metabolites, the bugs have been evolved not to eat. Okay, they have learned to ignore or not eat or circumvent themselves from these metabolites. So I did an experiment in the lab. What if we make these bugs eat these non-pathogenic or these other metabolites, which they usually don't eat? And the answer was, when they eat those metabolites, they basically become avirulent or non-pathogenic. In other words, they turn their toxin production down. More toxin, disease; less toxin, less disease, right? So what we have is that nature has programmed us and bugs to have this conversation. And the conversation basically is, what do bacteria eat when they cause disease? Usually, they eat the foods which make them pathogenic and make toxins. Sometimes, we can change these interactions by making the bugs eat things which sometimes make them non-pathogenic, right? So this is the handle we have on John. So now let's try and cure John, okay? So John has diarrhea, and we are going to see what can we do to help John. Okay, so this is the second experiment I did in the lab. I reasoned, if all of you are bacteria in John's body, you come inside this room, you are expecting pathogenic metabolites, right? And this is what you have been eating. Let's assume that's called steak, right? What if, when you walked into John's body, we make John give you the other green non-pathogenic metabolites, right? And let's call them salad, okay? So I said, okay, let's see what happens to John. And these are not steaks and salads, right? This is just for the purpose of the talk. These are organic molecules. You guys are smarter than me, so I'm assuming you got that, okay? So you did that. And basically what happens is, like, I was surprised. I failed miserably. The bugs wouldn't eat them. They would not like them. It's like training a pet, right? They're like, no, no. I'm like, okay. So finally, after a lot of screening, I identified a few metabolites which I thought would work. And if those would work, then let's see what happens to John. Does he get better? Does he get ill? What happens? So here's John, again drinking contaminated water. This is you guys eating steak. And we flush it, and we give them these new metabolites, right? The bugs don't know. They're eating them. They don't like them in the real sense. They become non-pathogenic. They turn the toxin production down, and they start exiting John's body in a non-infectious state, and John is happy. So there are a couple of things I hope you took from it. A, we did not kill them. Up till now, we have been killing them. And this is a concept that we need to think about, that infectious agents usually can be trained, can be modulated. Their diets can be changed. And what I'm thinking, and what we all should think, is there a way we can intersect into this problem of infectious diseases by providing bugs or training them the new generation of food sources? These food sources will make the bugs avirulent or non-pathogenic versus killing them. Okay? And after becoming avirulent or non-pathogenic, they are trained to exit our bodies in a way that's safe for us to pass them out. Let's assume in the future we design a system which I'm calling at this point on-demand food service for bugs. Okay? And the science behind this is really interesting. The science is that basically, when you get an infectious disease, instead of coming back with an antibiotic and killing the bugs, the first line or frontline therapy in the future should be and could be understanding or managing the infection by training the bugs, by giving them food sources, which instead of making them pathogenic, first make them non-pathogenic, non-infectious, and then if required, come back with antibiotics. Okay? So this concept allows us to use the antibiotics in a more rational way. It buys us time, basically, to look for better antibiotics which we are not able to find. And this allows us not to go back and start killing them all over again, because we did that 50 years back, and right now, they are resistant. So as the drawing board has been wiped clean all over the world with scientists, business, industry people looking for more drugs, this is a new approach where basically we have an opportunity to fix this problem the right way for once and hopefully for a long time. Because once we discovered penicillin, we stopped looking. And the bugs discovered penicillin too after 50 years, and they were like, hang on, I got a problem, okay? So there are a couple of take-home messages I want to take, want you to think about, that dietary needs of an infectious agent can be used to design novel antimicrobials, one. Second thing, large-scale deployment of these things is possible. We humans already have a network in place. Do you eat fortified wheat at home? Yes. Do you eat salt with iodine in it? Yes. So we already have a huge network of fortified foods rolling out in our communities, but up till now, these fortified foods only helped our health, right? You drink vitamin water, you get vitamins in our body. But the bugs have largely been ignored. So one of the things I'm working on is the next generation of oral rehydration salt solution. This is given to patients who have diarrhea like John, right? But all the oral rehydration salt solution does is replenish the salts and the metabolites in your body that you lose while you have diarrhea. It does nothing to the bugs. The bugs are just using John's body as a vehicle. The next generation of oral rehydration salt solutions that are going to come out, hopefully, will include these non-pathogenic metabolites that can be incorporated as frontline therapy before you get antibiotics. I want all of you to think about these things and discuss them and see if there are novel ways we can intersect into this problem of antibiotic resistance, because if not now, in the next 50 years, you're going to face it. Thank you.